Hey, everybody. Hey, everybody. I just want to welcome you in today. Hey, everybody. Hey, everybody. How are y'all doing on this beautiful day? Hey, Apostle T. Listen, I got to tell you, Apostle T, your word is coming to pass and I can't keep up. I cannot keep up with the blessing that God is bringing in our life. Hey, Naisha, how you doing, my boo? How you doing today, girl? Hey, thank you so much, Pastor Emily. I pray you having a good day, beautiful lady. I'm so proud of you walking further than before. You keep it up because God is just going to keep on expanding you and growing you all the more. Come on. Hey, Shawnetta. Hey, Miyoki. Hey, Kelly Kale. Hey, Mama's Blessing. Come on. Okay, Mama's Blessing. Can I tell you something? Every time I see your name and I see Mama's Blessing, I don't know why, but I want to say, hey, Mama's Blessings, Daddy's Lessons. I don't know why. Every time I see your name, that just comes to my mind. Y'all, make sure that y'all are liking, tagging, sharing this out. I just want to come and give you a word. Hey, Cicely. Hey, Tisha. Hey, Jazz. Good news about the oil, and I think it's more to come. Go ahead and tell me the good news you got about your oil, because y'all, I got to tell y'all some testimonies on what God did for me today. Hey, sis, my oil is coming tomorrow. I'm so excited. Praise God. Y'all, I just got to tell y'all some big old blessings that God is doing. And that's just honestly what kind of sparked up this word today. And if you were on this morning's prayer live, y'all already know that the fire of God has just been burning in me all day long. Okay. His fire is in me. Hold on, y'all. Let me get Shay on the live. That fire. Okay. Thank you so much. These are paparazzi earrings. Hey, Nige. Hey, Nasia. Or Niaja. You know your name. Hey, Denitra. Hey, Monica. Hey, Erica. Hey, Tammy. Y'all, can I just testify of God's goodness? Hey, P. Marie. So, y'all, today, like, y'all know we had our prayer this morning. Now, y'all say afternoon, but I say morning. And can I tell y'all something? So y'all know I put my Deeper Realms anointing on oil before I went. And Elijah put my oil of increase on my car. So my Telluride was leaking water from a clogged AC drain. Well, listen, y'all, we took it in today. Not only did they fix it for free, but on top of that, y'all, it was ready by today. And that's a blessing all in itself. Come on. Then on top of that, y'all, what else did God do? Because y'all, God did so much stuff. While we were there, one of the guys offered Elijah a job. But y'all, I told him, I said, my baby worth more than that. You're going to have to offer him more money if you want my man. Listen, you better know your man's worth, okay? All my ladies here, you better know your man is valuable. His time is valuable. Listen. So y'all, that happened. Then I had a celebrity today use my audio from one of my reels for their video. So I was like, come on, God. Then on top of that, y'all, we just launched our TikTok shop and we've already gotten 13 orders in our TikTok shop. Let me go to my regular Shopify account. So we got 13 orders on our TikTok shop. Then on our regular orders, we've gotten 10 orders today, y'all. And I'm just like, the list literally just goes on. I got blessed with this opportunity where one of my brothers, he asked me, would I be like a big sis, like an overseer in his ministry, y'all? And I told my team about it, told my husband about it, and I prayed about it. And God said, yes. So I'm excited that I get to be an overseer in the ministry, y'all. I'm really excited about that. And I'm just telling y'all, just blessing everywhere. I mean, everywhere we are seeing blessing today, y'all. Financial blessing, y'all. Getting to have a bigger role in ministry. And that's just such a blessing for me, you know, just to get to lift other ministers, get to pour in other ministers, get to be a covering for somebody. That's just, I don't take that lightly at all, y'all. And so I don't even know if that's everything, but I can just tell y'all one thing. God is over here blessing me so big. Listen, I ain't even got enough room to contain all this goodness and his mercy. And so I'm just like, Father God, help me to keep up with what you're doing. Can somebody say, God, help me to keep up with what you're doing? Because, see, I want you to prophesy over your life. I want you to put in the chat, say, God, help me to keep up with what you're doing. See, why are you saying this? Because you're shifting your season. I want you to just begin to speak that over yourself. And can I tell y'all one more testimony? Now listen. Y'all know my house payment ain't a cheap house payment. We pay about $1,600 a month because I have a 2,400 square foot home on 21 and a half acres. But that is still a good rate for me. My business, God blessed our business so much that the business was able to pay my house payment. I don't know. I talked to another business owner and she told me, she said, that is the dream. I'm like, well, if that's the dream, then I think I'm living it then. I just got to testify, because when God has been this good to somebody, you just can't even contain this, y'all. When God has poured out his blessing so big, listen, you just can't even keep this to yourself, okay? You got to share this with everybody. So listen, I want y'all to share out this live, invite somebody to the live today, because what God is about to do today, he's about to shift your season. Listen, I pray that you're ready for God to shift your season. But can I tell you that right before God shifts your season, he will have you start preparing for your season. See, today, y'all, God just literally begin to do all these miracles. And see, when I was putting, because I only got one product loaded and I still got many more to load. And this is, I got these orders that I tell you about. That's just off of one product. And as I was going to put the product on her, he said, my daughter, are you ready? He said, because Takaya, the moment that you step out and do this, I need you to know that it's going to be very overwhelming. Not in a bad way, my daughter. You're about to begin to get so many orders. And I need to know, are you ready for what you're about to step into? Can I tell you something? See, there are times when we're stepping into roles and stepping into places, and God is saying, I understand that you're stepping out, but are you ready for what you're getting ready to step into? Somebody say, God, prepare me for what I'm about to step into. Prepare me for the overflow that I'm about to step into. Because as I took a moment, I was like, you know, when you kind of like, God, I don't know. But I know that I've been sowing for overflow. I know I've been believing for overflow. I know I've been desiring overflow. So, Father God, if that's the case, so y'all, I didn't say yes, I didn't say no, y'all. I literally just put the product on there and said, God, I trust you. But see, can I tell some people here that with your blessing, there's going to come persecution? Because see, in Mark, I remember when Peter was telling Jesus, he was like, Jesus, he said, we left all these things for you. And see, Peter said, and then Jesus responds to Peter and he says, Peter, hold up. Y'all, I'm paraphrasing, but he says, Peter, there is no man that has ever left brother, father, sister, mother, houses, or land. God is basically saying there's not a person, a place, or an opportunity that you can leave behind for me that I will not give you back 100 times as much what you left. See, can I tell y'all that in order to go to my overflow, I had to leave behind the old version of Takaya. Hey, virgin. See, I had to be willing to leave my old lifestyle in order to become the prophetess. See, I had to be willing to leave my family members' approval and some people's approval in order to step into God's approval. Because how many of you know on today that the moment that you step into God's approval, then it almost feels like you're getting out of man's approval? It's like all of a sudden when you say, God, I want to be surrendered to you. God, I want to be accepted by you. That all of a sudden it feels like that in order to be accepted by God, I gotta go through a season of being rejected by man. Anybody know what I'm talking about on this good old Wednesday? It's Wednesday, yeah. Okay. Anybody know what I'm talking about? When you say, God, I surrender, and all of a sudden your family members start persecuting you. Who you think you are? Oh, you think you better than us? Oh, you think you holier than that? Nah, baby, I just think that I need a savior. I just think that I need Jesus working for me and leading and guiding me. And I know you may not understand the path that I'm on right now. I know you may not understand why I can't do the things I used to do. I know you may not understand why I can't drink the way I used to drink. I can't talk and gossip about everybody the way I used to, sis. See, listen, I can't hang around the people I used to. Listen, if your anointing is contaminated, I gotta keep the anointing on my life pure so I can connect with everything. Yeah, I understand you got all this following. Yeah, I understand that people, they call your name and you may know all these big leaders. But if God is telling me that I gotta keep myself pure and this connection is gonna cause an impurity in my life, then you may not understand it. But my goal is to be obedient to God. Why? Because God is preparing me for my season to change. See, I've noticed that when God is getting me ready. Have you ever noticed that when we're transitioning from summer to fall, that even before the dates for fall, which is September 23rd, right? Have you noticed that even before we get to the date on the calendar that says that the change is taking place, we already start getting a little glimpse of the change to come? You ever notice that even when we still in summer, that God will still give us a glimpse of what fall is getting ready to look like? Because have you ever noticed that right? But let's go ahead and go through fall. Have you ever noticed that in fall, we get a little glimpse of what winter is getting ready to look like? Why? Because see, listen, when your season is getting ready to change, what God will do is God will start giving you little glimpses here and there to kind of show you where your direction is headed. He will give you a little glimpses here and there to show you where your direction is getting ready to go. And see, God will give you little glimpses to kind of show you that, hold up, I need to take this word somewhere today. Listen, what God is doing for you, sis, is he's trying to tell you that you gotta, have you ever noticed, y'all, that when I'm getting ready to shift from summer to fall, all of a sudden I gotta get my fall clothes ready. Listen, I don't know about y'all, but I love me a fall sweater. See, when we getting ready to go into the fall season, right? Notice how all of a sudden the clothes that I wear has to shift. Because see, the clothes that I wear in summer, I don't wear them same clothes in fall. See, even when I'm shifting from fall to winter, the clothes that I would wear has to shift. And when I go from winter back to spring, then I got to shift. See, what is God trying to tell you? God is trying to tell us today that, listen, you got to shift with the shift. You got to understand that God giving you a glimpse of what's to come is his way of telling you that you need to go ahead and prepare your clothes. You need to go ahead and prepare yourself. You need to go ahead and start getting them clothes out. See, you got to start pulling back out some old boxes. You got to start pulling back out some things. You got to start rearranging in your closet. Why? Because God is shifting something in me. See, you may not understand why I'm over here rearranging my closet. You may not understand why all of a sudden I'm starting to pull out some stuff that you like, well, it ain't time for that. Because see, listen, how many of you know that you can't wait for the flood to come to build the ark? See, God was telling Noah about this flood is getting ready to come. There's about to be a shift on the earth, Noah. And Noah, I need for you to prepare for this shift. Why? Because see, Noah, I see something in you that makes me want to preserve you. But Noah, if you don't prepare, then you're going to succumb to the season. You're not going to be able to survive the season if you don't prepare for the season. Let me take a drink of my iron tea. That ain't bad. I can drink it. Y'all, I gotta start taking me this iron tea. Hey, Ariana Boo. So you gotta get ready. See, how many times do we want to wait for the flood to come? Oh, God, well, if I see the rain, then I'll build the ark. You know what I love about Noah is Noah didn't need to see a raindrop to do what God told him to do. See, the reason why some of you won't step out and do what God told you to do is because you're waiting on the raindrops. You're waiting on the perfect conditions. You're waiting on everything to look the way that you want it to look. And you've been telling God, oh, God, I'll step out when you give me another sign. But see, can I tell you something? God didn't have to show Noah rain clouds for him to obey God. God didn't have to show Noah rain clouds for him to obey God. See, he didn't need for the sky to tell him what God was telling him. Listen, can I tell somebody on today, you better stop waiting on the sky to tell you what God has already told you. Listen, you know what I see? Listen, y'all know them four. I know I say listen a lot, y'all, and that's because I'm from Texas. So if you knew her, flow with me. You ever notice how the Doppler forecast can show me rain that's coming even when the clouds don't tell me rain is coming? Come on. Have y'all ever noticed that? That the forecast can tell me that rain is coming, a storm is coming, that something is getting ready to come before I ever see it in the natural. See, how many times do we get angry when we see rain on the forecast, but we forget that the seeds that we've sown require water in order to grow? But can I talk to the people who don't like them sunny days? Because listen, how many of you know that I also need the sun? Because listen, that the plants and the trees and the seed that I sown requires also sun as well. Because see, have you ever noticed that it grows up towards the sun and it needs the sun in order to grow, but it also needs the rain in order to grow? And see, some of you are frustrated because see, you don't know how to trust God in your sunny season, but then some of you don't know how to trust God in the rainy season. And what you don't realize, that in order for your harvest to grow the way it's supposed to grow, you need both. See, can I tell y'all where this word came from today? See, today was a busy day. Like I say, y'all, we woke up this morning, I had to hurry up, get dressed. God told me to go live. We're trying to get to the dealership to drop off my Telluride. Then they tell me they ain't gonna be ready for 5 hours, but I can't stay in Waco for 5 hours. Then I gotta go get some shopping done, and me and Eli decide we're gonna go out to eat, y'all. Then after that, I had to hurry back to Mahia, make a TikTok video, ship off my TikTok orders, plus some of our orders, then hurry up and drop it right back off, and then get right back to Waco to pick up my Telluride. Then I had to go to Drug Emporium because God has dealt with our family and told us that we got to get healthy, because in order for us to go where God is taking us, we can't eat junk. And can I tell y'all something? When I was walking into Drug Emporium, right, there was this couple there, and you ever just felt like God was just drawing you to somebody? And I had to literally stop this couple, and I said, y'all, listen. I said, I know this may be crazy, but I got to be obedient to God. I got a word for y'all, and God had me prophesy over these people. And so then we get our stuff, y'all. Then I had to get gas. Then we got home. And as I'm on my way home, I'm listening to Prophet White preach. And oh, if you hear Prophet White, that word spoke to me. And I was just praying over you and praying for myself in this journey, y'all. And as I was driving, the Lord began to show me something. He said, Takiyah, because I looked on the side to me and all I seen was these cornfields, and they were so beautiful. And God told me, he said, do you remember when that grass was burned? He said, you remember when you drove past it and all it looked like was burned, barren land, my daughter? And I'm like, yeah, God. He says, seasons change. And I was like, oh, God, I gotta preach this word. And tonight is supposed to be Apostle Eli's night to preach. And I said, baby, can I preach tonight? Because I got this word. He said, yes. Thank you, baby. That's going to be such a blessing to me to preach. And I'm like, well, praise God. We on the same page, y'all. And I got here y'all had a little time with my kids and then got on the live. And the Lord showed me something. He was showing me how My daughter, do you remember that season where this grass was burned, where this grass looked like it was dead, and this grass didn't look how you see it today? But see, now all of a sudden, in a different season, that same grass that looked barren, that same land that looked like it couldn't produce nothing, now has these cornfields that are, the corn has grown about 5 to 6 feet tall, however tall it was. And God was showing me in that moment how it's like you can be in one season where it looks like you're going through the fire, where it looks like you're being burned, where it looks like everything is dead and barren and like no fruit can come out of you. But then all of a sudden, you can go back and look at that same land and you can see your harvest. You can see God's overflow. You can see what God is doing. You can see how it required, because see, farmers have to burn the land in order to prepare for the new harvest. And see, some of you have gone through the burning season and you've been saying, God, I've gone through my fire. God, I don't know how I'm going to make it through this. And God is trying to tell you, listen, the reason why you had to go through the burning season is because the burning of the ground was the preparation for the harvest. Somebody said, I came to your page right at the right time. I'm in tears cleaning my kitchen. Come on. See, I had to realize that what if I would have just stayed stuck in the season where I was being burned? See, what if I would have just only looked at that land when it was in its burning season, but I never would have saw the next season of that land? I would have never been able to know what God could do. And see, how many times do we stop in our burning season? How many times do we stop in the wilderness, Ariana? How many times do we stop on our business and we start giving up when all of a sudden when things aren't working anymore? How many times do we say, God, maybe I'm going to stop sowing. I'm going to stop trusting you. Why? Because God, I'm not seeing the harvest that you told me I was going to have. And see, what if the farmer gave up after 5 days of planting the seed? What if he came back after 5 days of planting the seed and said, you know what? I'm going to give up on the seed, Ariana, because listen, I don't see nothing happening. But what if he came back a month later and it wasn't as tall as he wanted it to be? Yeah, he saw some growth and he saw some potential, but he didn't see the fullness of the harvest. What if he gave up? And imagine how many of you right now, because you don't see the potential, or maybe you do see potential, but you don't see the fullness and you're like, God, yeah, you do something, but God, that's not enough to pay my bills every month. Yeah, God, I know that you let me sell one cup here and there, God, but that's not enough to pay my rent this month, God. God, I know you're doing something in my life, but God, I need more than that. And God is saying, can you still trust me in the midst of the potential? God said, can you still trust me? Even when you don't see it, I told y'all my testimony so many times of how I literally gave up on my boutique and now look at what God is doing. And I said, I gotta tell this testimony because so many people think that this is just what it's always been. But what you don't understand is I sat behind closed doors and I came on these lives and I didn't tell y'all about it. But I would literally be sitting here. I'm a failure. I'm not good enough. Here go another business that I started and failed. Look at you. You doing like you always do. You always start stuff to Kaya and you quit. You always do stuff and you give up on yourself when you don't see the money coming in. You don't think I ain't had to fight that fight. But can I tell you that all of a sudden when I went through my burning season, I had to come out. Oh, somebody needs to know today that you gotta come out, sis. See, summer may feel like a long time, but it cannot. Who that dog is? Who right about set here? Y'all listen. Huh? Y'all, I felt something biting at my foot, and I didn't know what it was. And I look under the table, and all I see is this little dog just... And it freaked me out. See, some of you, God is biting at you today. Sis, I just ordered my oil. Praise God. But see, sis, some of y'all right now, this word, that word is doing... Listen, this word is doing what this dog was doing to my foot. See, do y'all notice how this dog kept biting until it got my attention? I think it sees my foot as a threat. But see, some of you, God is using this word to say, hey, Pastor Emily, Shay, Tanise, Katrina, Ariana, come on, listen. I'm trying to get your attention. Why? Because last night you was praying and asking God, when is this season going to end? God, I'm tired of crying. I'm tired of going through this fire. I'm tired of going through being burned. God, when is it going to end? And God is saying, hey, this your answer today. You hear this word, my daughter? My son, it's my way of trying to tell you I'm talking to you. See, God is trying to get your attention today. Can I tell y'all that I haven't even started the word in the way that it's supposed to come out, but I've started some of it. I want to go over to 1 Kings chapter 3. The Lord kind of gave me an order in the which way we're going to do this. So we're going to flow the way that God wants me to flow this. Okay, so this is how we're going to flow this. I told you my story. Then after that, we're about to talk about Solomon. Then we're going to talk about the woman with the vessels. Then we're going to go over to Ecclesiastes. Then we're going to talk about Malachi on how God's going to pour out a blessing so big you can't even contain it. Then we're going to talk about Amos 9:13 through 15, because it's going to be one thing fast on the heels of the other. Can we do that? Go to 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 14, and share this out with somebody. It says, now Solomon became a son-in-law to Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and formed an alliance by taking Pharaoh's daughter in marriage. He brought her to the city of David, where she remained temporarily until he had finished building his own house, palace, and the house of the Lord, the wall around Jerusalem. Why I feel like some of you women who are getting ready for your husband can learn a lesson from Solomon right there. Notice what it said. That before he brought his wife home, he finished his house, which was a palace. He also finished the house of the Lord. So he had an honor and a reverence for God and the wall around Jerusalem. So before he brought his wife back, he said, I have got to be obedient to do what God has called me to do. Listen, can I tell every woman here who is praying to God for your man? Oh, I pray that God will send you a man who establishes these things before he ever comes to you. That before he ever even comes to you, talk about taking you as his wife. He already has got a relationship with God. He's already done built the things that he needs in order to sustain you, that he's our, because listen, the Bible says, because can I tell y'all something? Before God gave Eve to Adam, God gave Adam a place. Come on. God gave Adam work. Come on. God gave Adam an assignment. Come on. And God gave Adam a relationship with him. Can I tell you, sis, before you get your man, you better, he needs to already have his work, have his assignment, have a relationship with God. He needs to already have a place. Come on. What was God doing? God was giving us an example. I'm trying to prepare y'all for y'all kingdom husbands. Because I got some, I know there's some women up in here getting married this year. So I just want to throw that in there. It says, but in the meantime, the people were still sacrificing to God on the high places, hilltops, as the pagans did to their idols. For there was no permanent house yet built for the name of the Lord. So basically, they were still having to go up to these hilltops to sacrifice to God, because there had not been built a temple. There had not been built a place for them to be able to give their offering, give their seeds, and sacrifice to God. And it says, now Solomon loved the Lord. Oh, I pray that your husband loves the Lord. It says, walking at first in the statutes of David, his father. Notice that his relationship with God didn't start in his later years of life. His relationship with God came from him following his father. See, it came from watching his father. And it came from seeing how his father honored God. It came from that. See, can I tell every parent here that we have a responsibility to train our children up in God, because our children are watching us, and our children are watching to see. Because listen, if you don't value your time with God, why would your children value their time with God? If your children don't value, if you don't honor God's house, why would your children honor God's house? If you don't value the word of God, why would your children value the word of God? If you don't have a reverence for him, why would they? Can I tell you something? If you dishonor your pastor, why you shocked when your kids dishonor their leader? Can I tell you that our children don't do what we say, they do what they see. See, it's easy for your children to disrespect their teachers because they listen to you disrespect your boss and your leaders. And it's easy for us to tell our children to make a change that we're not willing to change. See, when your kids are doing things that you don't agree with, you might want to ask, where did they learn it from? And don't be shocked when it comes back to you. Because it's easy to blame everybody else when they spend more time with you. Come on, I just got to stomp that word for a second. So it says that, except for the fact that he sacrificed and burned incenses in the high places, ignoring the law that required all sacrifices to be offered at the tabernacle. It says the king went to Gibeon near Jerusalem, where the tabernacle and the bronze altar stood. This little dog, y'all. And it says to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. And Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. In Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream at night, and God said, ask me what I shall give to you. Then Solomon said, you have shown your servant David, my father, great loving kindness, because he walked before you in faithfulness and righteousness and uprightness of heart towards you. Can y'all give me a moment? Addison! Oh, never mind. Y'all, this dog is over here chewing on paper. And I'm like, what are you doing? See, do you notice how Solomon studied to see why God blessed his father the way he did? Have you ever took a moment to study to see why God is blessing somebody the way that he is? Have you ever took a moment to really begin to look deeper to say, why do they have influence? Why is their marriage blessed? Why is their ministry blessed? Why are their children so respectful? What is it that is causing the blessing of God to be evident in their life? And can I tell you something? That we have to be willing to take wisdom. We have to be willing, because can I tell you something? That when you understand wisdom, then you understand that when you see God lifting somebody and God blessing somebody, instead of judging them, the best thing you could do is go to them and say, hey, can you tell me what you're doing to cause that result in your life? Pastor Emily said, I've been studying you more lately. How many of y'all have been studying me? This is funny. That's not where I thought we were going in that, Pastor Emily. See, I was listening to my spiritual father. And in listening to my spiritual father, Latoya said me, I was listening to my spiritual father, and he said some things to me. Hey, Ariam. And can I tell y'all that if I would have went in that meeting today, when they offered my husband that job, when we were sitting there and they offered my husband that job, right? If I would have never heard what my spiritual father said yesterday, I would have thought that was a good deal. So yesterday, I'm listening to my spiritual father, and he says this statement. He said, a company asked me, could they pay me to wear their clothes? He said, I asked them how much. And I sat there puzzled. Because see, so many times as Christians, we're taught that we're supposed to be broke. We're not supposed to make money. We're supposed to just kind of just like, poverty is equated to humility, right? And he said, and he said, they offered to pay him $182,000, right? Now, 182,000 pounds. Now, some of you would be like, oh my goodness, yes. He said, I told them, that's not enough. And I was like, because I'll be honest with y'all, they told me that. I'm like, oh God, you know? And he said, that's not enough. And I'm intrigued. He said, because I sat to wonder, how did they get to this number of $182,000? And then as I sat to wonder, and I'm thinking to myself, if you can pay $182,000, why can't you pay me $200,000? That's what he said. And that made me realize, and I went back to Jordan, and I said, Jordan, my spiritual father said when somebody wanted to pay him to wear their clothes, he asked him how much. Jordan, we got to ask how much. He said, if you understood your value, if you understood your worth, then your response would be different. See, I had to sit there and I'm digesting what he said. He said, and then I realized something. If they'll pay me $200,000 to wear their clothes, and I know that they're going to get a greater return on that, then why don't I just start my own clothing line and make more money? And I'm like, okay, come on. And I was like, and I told Jordan that too. And I was like, see, yeah, that's my kind of thinking right there, right? So as we went into this meeting, as we're sitting there and he offers to pay my husband this money to work for him, I said, I remembered what my spiritual father said, because what does the Bible say? See, Jesus said, I only do what I see my father do. And there's something that God showed me the other day. And this is in regard to spiritual leaders and spiritual parents, okay? God showed me something the other day in my prayer closet. And after God showed me this, it got me something. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17. Obey your spiritual leaders and submit to them, recognizing their authority over you, for they are keeping watch over your souls and continually guarding your spiritual welfare as those who will give an account of their stewardship of you. Let them do this with joy and not with grief and groans, for this would be of no benefit of you. And then my spiritual father said something. He said, listen, he said, whenever you are operating in submission to your leader, you have access to whatever your leader has access to. So when I submit to my spiritual father, if my spiritual father is wealthy, I have access to that. My spiritual father prophesies, I have access to that. My spiritual father has this grace, I have access to that. Because whatever you submit to, you come under that authority of that thing. And whatever authority you are under will determine what you get, right? So, going off of the merit of what my spiritual father taught us, right? When this guy offered my husband the job, I said, no, that's not enough. I said, because if we could make $1,000 in a day, then why would he work for you making $1,000 in a week? And I'm telling my auntie this story, and she's sitting here like, Takaya, you need that $1,000. And I said, no, God can do more. And you know what he said, listen, I get it. That's all I can offer you. And I was like, and that's fine. And we were able to have a mutual understanding. Like, listen, you got to get to a place where you recognize and understand your value. See, sometimes we are so hungry for something that we devalue ourselves to get it. See, I've had to learn that I've been so hungry for relationships that I would devalue myself to have relationships. I was so hungry to have people in my life that I would devalue myself in order to have them. Can I tell you, there was a version of me that I wanted a relationship so bad that I got in domestic violence relationships, and I let people take advantage of me, and I let the person I was with talk to me like I was crazy. Why? Because I was so desperate for a relationship. And when you get to a place of desperation, it's like all of a sudden your morals go out the window. You ever notice that when you get desperate, all of a sudden your value goes right out the window? And I had to say, no. I would rather trust and believe what God can do than to settle for less. And man, I used to devalue myself 24/7. I'm so glad God, come on. See, so many times we're devaluing our worth and not seeing ourselves the way God sees us. Can I tell you that in this next season, you're gonna have to own your worth and add tax, baby. You're gonna have to realize your value. As I told y'all, today I launched my TikTok shop. Can I tell y'all something? I made a lot of Christians mad selling anointing oil today. And you know, God has showed me that there's still some of me that struggle with people pleasing. And so I had a few people commenting on my videos, woman of God, and they always sound so holy to y'all. And I'm not saying they ain't God's kids, okay? But they're like, woman of God, don't put a price tag on anointing oil because God can give you the provision. And see, in their minds, they think that I'm selling anointing oil because I'm broke. They think I'm selling anointing oil because I just need the money. Not realizing the reason why I'm doing this is because God told me to do it. Because can I tell you something? If God told me to sell hats tomorrow, we'd be selling hats tomorrow. Because we're going to do whatever God tells us to do. But that's their mindset. Then I had another person say, God, you need to deal with them. You need to get them. God, they are profiting off your oil. They are profiting off of your name, saying that you said it. And God, this is not right, and you need to get them. And I'm just sitting here like, Lord. And I'm going to be, can I be real and transparent with y'all? Can I tell you that because of some of the comments, I almost shut down my TikTok shop? I'm going to be real and tell you, I almost did it today. Yes, she did. But I fought my flesh, and God told me, he said, no, you ain't doing that. And God kept telling me, he's like, Takiyah, I told you to do that. It don't matter what they say. I told you to do that. And I called and I was telling Eli about it. And I told him, I said, baby, I'll be honest with you. I find myself feeling overwhelmed because I'm getting all these orders on my TikTok shop, and I'm getting all these orders in my boutique, and the blessing is so much that, transparently speaking, I'm kind of afraid because it's so big. And I said, and with the blessing though, I got a lot of people that are persecuting me at the same time. And I know that the bigger this thing gets, the more people are going to say stuff to me, baby. So I really just feel overwhelmed, right? And then I called I called Apostle Shay, and I said, Shay, hey, listen, I'm not going to give up, but I do need you to pray for me because I'm not going to sit in and lie to you, Shay. I do kind of find myself kind of feeling like, you know, these comments that people are making. She said, where they at? I'll go delete their comment. Y'all, Shay was ready to go off on all these people. Y'all don't understand. Shay is like my top flight security guard. She is my bodyguard. She like, don't play about me. and she's like about to go off. And I said, no, Shay, I already deleted it. And can I tell y'all something? As I was driving home, because when I tell y'all my drive, God was just downloading so much to me. He said, Takiyah. Oh, Ariana, you know that Shay don't play. Let me go to a scripture. I want to show y'all something. Oh, y'all, she is the assistant pastor in my ministry for a reason. A very big reason. Y'all have no idea how many times that girl keep me going. Hold on, I'm looking for the scripture. Where is it at, God? Show me where it is. I'm telling y'all, obedience is everything. You right. Oh, maybe it's in Isaiah 55. Maybe it's in Isaiah 55. Let me see. God showed me this scripture. And he began to speak this to me. But one part I want to tell you that God told me. He said, Takiyah. He said, do you remember the woman who had that oil? And she broke that oil. And she put it on me that was a part of my preparation for me in my burial. He said, my daughter, that oil was worth over, over 13 grand. It's a lot how much that oil is worth. I think it's like 30 grand. And he said, and my daughter, you're worried about selling $25 oil, $12.50 oil, when the oil that woman put on me was way more costly than even what I have you doing? He said, my daughter, you be obedient to do what I told you to do. Because God was showing me today, there are many Christians who don't see any value in the things of God. See, we see value in an electricity bill. We see value in our house. We see value in Louis Vuitton bags. We see value in these Eunice and Love Me wigs. And we see value in the things of the world. But why is it that the body of Christ doesn't see value in the things of God? You see, God was showing me something, that there are many people that the reason why they're making these statements, my daughter, is because they don't see the things of God as value. They only see the things of this world as value. But when it comes to the things of God and the work of the Lord, see, we see the work of the Lord as something that holds no value, that should be free, that should be given to us. But we don't mind paying for the things of this world. And God was showing me that, my daughter, you can either stop your blessing because of the people who don't see the value, or you can keep going forward for the people who do see the value. You can either be obedient and see my blessing, or you can be disobedient and stop my blessing. What are you gonna do? See, how many times do we stop the blessing of the Lord because there are people with opinions? How many times do we stop doing what God told us to do because of people's opinions? Now, I'm going to get back to the word. Now, I want to get back to scripture. I'm going to tie this in. So it said, God said, ask me, what shall I give you? That's what God told to Solomon. He said, you have shown your servant David, my father, great love and kindness, because he walked before you in faithfulness and righteousness and with uprightness of heart towards you. And you have kept him for this great love and kindness, in that you have given him a son to sit on the throne as it is today. Basically, he was saying, he said, God, I have watched and seen how you bless my father. But I also see that you didn't just bless my father, but when you gave me to my father, you also gave me as an extension of the blessing. Can I tell you that your children will, I want to decree and declare that your children is going to be an extension of the blessing of God. That your children is going to be an extension of the grace of God. Your kids will be an extension of his glory. Come on. See, it says, and this is what it says in verse 7. So now, O Lord, my God, you have made your servant king in place of David, my father. And as for me, I am but a little boy in wisdom and experience. See, he says, God, I understand that my season is getting ready to change. My position has changed. I'm not just a little boy, but I'm a king now. And see, I understand that when I was just a little boy, there are certain things that I could do. But now that I'm a king, I require some things that I didn't require as just a little boy. Can I tell you that as God elevates you, there are going to be things that you're going to require that you may not require where you at right now. There's going to be some wisdom that you're going to need. There's going to be some advice, some knowledge, some understanding that you're going to need in where God is taking you. Because in where God is getting ready to take you to, the information that you have, because you will always notice that God is getting ready to take you to another level when the information you have right now doesn't work in your new place. Can I tell you that in order to be the boss, I can't act like an employee? I told y'all this. In order to be the CEO, I can't even act like the business owner. Because in where God is getting ready to take you, oh, can I tell every woman here today? Can I tell you that the information that you have as a girlfriend ain't gonna work when you become a wife? Because see, when I became Elijah's wife, I can't act like a girlfriend no more. Because can I tell you that as a girlfriend, I can leave at any given time. But as a wife, I gotta stay here and work it out. See, as a girlfriend, I can just disconnect and not talk to him for a few days. But as his wife, I can't let the sun go down on my anger. See, as a girlfriend, I may be able to get away with some stuff. But now that I'm a wife, all of a sudden, I can't do that no more. Why? Because my position has changed. And because my position has shifted, the way that I handle my relationships as a girlfriend, I can't handle that as a wife anymore. See, can I tell y'all that that the things that I even do as a wife, I can't do them as a mother. See, because the needs of my husband is different than the needs of my children. See, the way that I have to be there for my children is a different way that I have to be for my husband. So in order to be, because see, as a wife, I can be an encourager. But as a mother, I got to be a nurturer. And see, in order to be that nurturer, I got to know how to be able to encourage my kids, but also be able to come down to their level in such a way that even at their age, they can understand it. Why? Because my position has changed. See, as God shifts your position, see, today, when God spoke to me about being an overseer, and my brother's, in my brother's ministry, my prayer wasn't for money, my prayer wasn't for influence or none of that. Let me tell you what my prayer was. I said, Father, because y'all got to understand, I'm 28 years old, okay? I'm 28 years, and I'm feeling a lot like King Solomon today, okay? I'm 28 years old, right? I already lead we have an international ministry, right? And I have a bunch of, you know, I got spiritual sons and daughters who have stuff, but not to where we going in this thing. And, well, some of them, yes, but it's a little different when you're doing it for somebody in the sense of like as a brother, sister, overseer kind of thing. And I said, Father, give me wisdom and discernment for this role that you're putting me in. Because in myself, in Takiyah, I am not enough and I don't have enough information to do this correctly. So I need for you to give me wisdom and information, because if you are giving me this opportunity and if you are telling me yes, I need you to help me because I can't do this by myself. See, that's what King Solomon was saying. He said, you have made your servant king. See, notice he was a servant of God before he was a king. He said, I am but a little boy in wisdom and experience, and I do not know how to go out or come in. That is how to conduct business as a king. See, humility will take you further and pride will take you backwards. See, Solomon had to humble himself enough to say, God, for the place that you're taking me to, I don't know how to do the role. You ever had a title but didn't know how to do the role? Ever been called to do something but you don't know how to do it? Ever been given a word by God and said you're gonna be a prophetess, you're gonna be a prophet, you're gonna be literally the mother of nations, and you over here like, God, I'm just trying to be a mama to my biological kids, okay? You ever been given a word where God tells you that when God calls you to something, but the assignment requires you to do things that you don't have enough information to do? You ever been given a position where literally you don't even know how to do what God has called you to do? Somebody said assistant pastor. Come on. Because see, sometimes God is calling you to a place. And can I tell you that sometimes God will give you the title before he gives you the ability to know how to perform the title. See, Solomon was already called to be a king before he knew how to be a king. See, sometimes you look at yourself and you like, I don't know how I'm going to do this, God. I don't know how I'm gonna run this business. God, I don't know nothing about business, but can I tell you that just because you don't know nothing about a business don't mean God ain't still calling you to be a business owner. Oh, you're going to be a mother and you over here like, God, where's the husband at though? Because I know we ain't doing this by myself. Oh, you're going to be a wife and you like, God, all my relationships are toxic. How I'm going to be somebody's wife? I barely even know how to be somebody's girlfriend. Oh, you're going to be, oh, can I say this one? Oh, you're going to be a mother and you over here like, God, I'm still healing from my toxic one. How can I be somebody's mama when I wasn't even raised on how to be a mama? And see, sometimes God is calling you to a place. Matter of fact, all the time. I'm just going to say all the time. Because there is rarely. Oh, yeah, we just got another TikTok order. Come on, God. God will rarely call you to a place that you're prepared for. Let me tell you now, God will rarely call you to a place that you're prepared for. Come on. See, he said, I don't know how to do this. Can you be humble enough to say, God, I don't know how to do what you're telling me to do. So God, I need you to give me some wisdom. He says, so give your heart. Okay, I'll tell Addison in a minute. Thank you so much. Thank you just for that comment, okay? He says, give your servant an understanding mind and a hearing heart with which to judge your people. So that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to judge and rule this great people of yours? See, he said, God, the assignment that you are giving me, God, requires me to conduct business in a way that is beyond my jurisdiction. So God, I need for you to give me wisdom, and I need for you to give me understanding, and I need for you to help me, because God, in my own strength, I can't do this, God. But in your strength, I can do this. It says, now it pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this thing. And God said to him, because you have asked this and have not asked for yourself a long life, nor for wealth, nor for the lives of your enemy, but have asked for yourself understanding to recognize justice, behold, I have done as you asked, and I have given you a wise and discerning mind, so that no one before you was your equal, nor shall anyone equal to you arise after you. I have also given you what you have not asked, both wealth and honor, so that there will not be anyone equal to you or among you from all the kings all of your days. If you walk in my ways and keep my statutes and my commandments as your father David did, then I will lengthen your days. See, before it says, and I'll say this, it says, then Solomon awoke and he arose and he realized that it was a dream, and he came back to Jerusalem, stood before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, and he offered burnt offerings and peace offerings, and he prepared a feast for all his servants. Can I point out something? I'm going to briefly talk about it because I don't really want to go in depth in this today. Do you notice that word from God prompted him to be a sower, prompted him to give to God? Notice how he received this prophetic word from the Lord, and it prompted him to give to God. See, I want to point this message out because I want to point out how God made Solomon to be the wealthiest one, not because Solomon asked for wealth, but because Solomon asked that God would give him wisdom in order to be the king that God had called him to be. See, God gave him more because Solomon's heart was surrendered to God. But can I also tell you something? God gave Solomon more because Solomon also didn't mind giving to God. Solomon wasn't stingy when it came to God. Solomon didn't withhold back when it came to God, but Solomon gave to God. Solomon released to God. Solomon understood where his help came from. Solomon understood where his wisdom came from. Solomon understood who was going to be the one to help him in that position. How many times do we get in positions and we forget who got us there? And the reason why God distinguished Solomon is because Solomon's heart posture was correct. So as God shifts your title and he shifts you to another level in your title, notice that one of the things that God did before he was able to go fully into it, God prompted him to give. God gave him more wisdom. God gave him humility, because the Bible says that humility comes before honor. And God gave him more wisdom. That before God, when God is getting ready to lift you, you will always notice that he will begin to give you a hunger for wisdom. He will begin to give you a hunger for knowledge and understanding. Because what is God doing? God is preparing you for where he's getting ready to take you. That's one story amongst another one. Now I want to show you another one. I want to talk about the woman with the jars of oil. Y'all pray for this puppy. I want to talk about the woman with the jars of oil. And do you notice that both of these stories, a word came before the shift came? I want you to notice that. Before the shift came, a word came. You will notice that right before God shifts you, he will speak to you. Isaiah 55:11 says, so shall it be that when your word goes forth, it will not return back void, but it will prosper into the area in which the word was sent. I want you to notice that. Now go to 2 Kings 4. It says, now one of the wives of a man of the sons of the prophet cried out to Elisha for help, saying, your servant, my husband, is dead. You know that your servant reverently feared the Lord, but the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be his slaves in payment for a loan. Notice that right before God gave this woman a breakthrough, she was in a situation where she required a breakthrough. I want y'all to hear this. Right before God gave her more than enough, she was in a situation where it looked like she didn't have enough. So what if the mere fact that it looks like you don't have enough is an indication that God is getting ready to give you more than enough? I say that again. What if you not having enough is a mere indication that God is about to give you more than enough? And I can tell you a testimony. Last year, I was in a situation where I was getting ready to lose my house and like I was getting ready to lose everything. And literally, we literally had to come up with $3,200 or they were gonna take our house, y'all. And literally we had a day to come up with the money. And I had an option where I either was going to trust God or I said, you know what, God? I said, God, if you take this house, take it. But if we keep the house, God, then I'm good. Either way it go, God, I'm good, because I'm not going to allow a house to come between me and you, God. So if I have the house, great. But if you take it, God, I understand. And Elijah was a little overwhelmed about it, but this was the one time I wasn't worried. Like normally I'd be worried and stressed, but this time I just had a peace. I was okay either way. And Elijah made a call, and the people that Elijah made the call to, God told me they're going to give you that money. And I kid you not, I called my best friend to pray. We prayed and God said, I'm going to give you that money. And I just knew. So you know what I did, y'all? I went and took my bath. We had a day, but listen, what am I going to do? Sit here? Can I tell you that if I could have stayed up all night, can I tell you that staying up all night ain't going to make that bill get paid any faster? So you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to sleep. And I'm going to have peace, and I'm not going to stay up worried about what I cannot change. Because God, he said that worry won't add one cubic to my life. And so what is the point of me staying up, not sleeping, worried about something that my lack of sleep ain't going to change? So I went in there and I said, I'm going to take a bath. And so I literally went in there, y'all, and I took my bath. And do you know, as I'm sitting there taking my bath, LaToya, Eli was on the phone, right? And he gets a call. Hey, we're going to send y'all the money tomorrow. $3,200. They sent us $3,200, y'all. And literally, I mean, it was like, you know what I learned in that moment? I learned in that moment. See, I could have went in my bed and worried. But instead, I went in my tub and relaxed. And I noticed that the more I worry, the longer it takes. But the more that I act like it's already done, the quicker it gets done. So what if instead of you staying up tonight worried about things you can't change, you just went to sleep and just know that God's going to take care of it in the morning anyways? What if instead of you sitting over there making all these plans and stuff like that, because imagine you making plans to move out and God is making plans to make that thing be paid in full. Imagine that you making plans to literally give up on it, but God is over here making plans on how he about to overflow you. And instead of you, listen, if you're going to stay up all night, at least stay up all night to prepare for the harvest. Don't stay up all night to prepare, because isn't it amazing how we will lose sleep to prepare to lose everything, but we'll never lose sleep to prepare to keep everything. Oh, that's deep right there. Come on. That's deep right there. Come on. We will sit there and give all of our time to the problem, but we don't give none of our time to the solution. If you're going to stay up all night worried about it and stuff, then at least go in your prayer closet then, baby. Come on. At least go in there and say, God, I'm about to stay in here until you move. Y'all remember that woman with the unjust judge? Listen, the Bible says that's what it's like. Listen, with that unjust judge, y'all, you know what she did? She sat there bugging him till she got her breakthrough. Some of you got to get to the point where you just keep bugging God and say, God, I'm going to keep praying. I'm going to stay right here. I'm going to show up. God, I'm going to keep giving. If all I got is 10 cents to sow, God, I'm sowing my 10 cents, God. Why? Because I'm letting you know I ain't laxing on this thing, God. Y'all, I'm telling y'all something. Listen, I have learned that the longer I worry, the longer it takes for God to do it. The reason why Keisha, God said your worry is your disobedience. Woo. Y'all, I got a rock side to side for that word. Your worry is your disobedience. Woo. Y'all, I know y'all think that this is, y'all, well, I turned to the exact place I needed to go to. Can I read a scripture in Matthew chapter 6? Matthew chapter 6. Therefore, it says in verse 27, and who of you by worrying can add 1 hour to the length of his life? He said, who of you by worrying can add 1 hour to your life? You're literally wasting all these hours of your life worrying, and all you're doing is stealing your own time. Because the devil can't take what you won't give. Whew. Y'all, that kind of like was one of them gut words. Y'all, why? Listen, y'all want to know how I know this word is deep tonight? Because because my I got only one moderator working, and I know I got every last one of them here, okay? See, God is saying to us today, are you going to keep, because can I gotta stand up to say this, y'all, because what I need to say is I can't sit on this, okay? Woo. I gotta stand up to say this, y'all. Y'all wanna know what God just told me? He says some of you are acting like he not gonna come through. Every time you stay up late worrying, you acting like he not gonna come through. Every single time that you hesitate to sow that seed that God told you to sow a long time ago, that's just you acting like he ain't gonna multiply it. I had to walk off because I don't. Shay, pray for me. Pray for me today. Some of you acting like God ain't gonna come through. God said every single time that you planning on what it's gonna be like when they take your car, you acting like he ain't gonna come through. Every time you planning what it's gonna be like if they take your house, you acting like he ain't gonna come through. Ooh, some of you been over here acting like God ain't gonna come through. Come on. Every single time that you delay doing that video, making that live, starting that business that God told you to start, you acting like he ain't gonna bless it. Every single time you sitting there not doing what you know God told you to do, you over there acting like he ain't gonna come through. Some of you been acting like God ain't gonna come through. Matter of fact, I gotta be real, y'all. There's some areas in my life where I know I've been acting like God ain't gonna come through. Whoo! I'm sorry, God. Can we all just repent together and say, forgive me, Lord? Come on. I'm going to say it again. Every single time you stay up every night worried about your bills, you acting like God not gonna come through. You are preparing for him not to come through. Every time you don't sow that seed he told you to sow, every time you don't pay your tithe the way he told you to do it, you acting like he ain't gonna come through. Every time you don't start that business he told you to start, you acting like he ain't gonna come through. Every time you don't make that video like he told you to, you acting like he ain't gonna come through. Every single time, this the one, Toya, every time you don't order that inventory that he told you to get, you acting like he ain't gonna come through. Listen, y'all, Ariana, I could be wrong, but I gotta tell you this, and I'd rather be wrong and tell you than anything. He said, every time you put off looking at these wedding dresses and mapping out the vision and the plan, and every time you put off looking at these venues, you acting like he ain't gonna give you that husband that he told you he'd give you. I know. And God is telling me why. Because you feel like you look foolish. And you tired of getting your heart broken and you tired of being let down. Man, I remember a season in my life when God would tell me to go look at vehicles, and every time they kept telling me no, kept telling me no, kept telling me no. But then that last time I went, it was a yes. Whew. Come on. And see, some of us got some really good excuses on why we acting like God ain't gonna come through. Because see, most of you that are here today, the reason why you acting like God ain't gonna come through is because you keep feeling like you keep going through moments where you don't feel like he ain't coming through. See, some of the reason why you feel the way you feel, you not being obedient to do what you know God told you to do, is because you're afraid of it not happening, or you're afraid of the rejection or the abandonment. And so you would rather not do it and prepare to fail than do it and allow God to cause you to succeed. Whew. I need y'all to know this is as heavy as it is for me as everybody else in this room. That's why when I start getting kind of antsy, I start like, oh God, why? I just text my team. I said, why? See, God is saying that some of you, instead of trusting him, you are preparing for God to not come through on your behalf. Instead of being obedient to do what God has told you to do, you're preparing for God to not come through and do what he said he'd do. What are the areas where you've been preparing for God to not give you the breakthrough? Every night you stay up worrying. Every time you're making plans for it not to work out. Every time you're hesitating to get the inventory that he told you to get. Every single time that you're not doing all the things he told you to do. And the only reason why you're not being obedient to God is because you're preparing for him not to come through. See, can I tell you that some of you won't do the live that God told you to do? Because you don't really believe that he gonna speak through you the way that he said he would. The reason why you won't even step into the role of the prophet that you know God has called you to be is because you're afraid that if you were to step in the role, what if you miss it and get it wrong? So you're preparing for God to not give the words you need to speak instead of preparing for God to give you the words that you need to speak. Whew. How many of us being convicted? I hold my hands up. See, the reason why you're not getting the results that you want to get is because you are preparing to fail. Every night that you're staying up worrying, you're preparing for God to not provide. Every time that you're sitting there going back on the word that God told you to do, you're preparing for God to not show you what he can do with that word. Every single time that you sit there not giving the seed that God told you to give, because can I tell you something, that you either an eater or a sower. And every time you eat your seed, because do you notice that he doesn't say bread multiplies? He said seed multiplies. And the reason why you're not seeing God multiply the way you want him to multiply is because instead of being a sower, you're being an eater. So you only receive bread and enough to get by, but you never receive the overflow you're praying for. And so, because see, some of you, it's easier. Some of you have been, help me God, some of us, and I say this without humility, have gotten so used to living paycheck to paycheck that we do only enough for God to stay in the algorithm of paycheck to paycheck. I remember talking to someone telling them how God told me that if I wanted to get out of my season, I needed to act like my season changed. But see, I'll be honest to tell y'all, I didn't want to act like my season changed, okay? Because I'm going to tell you now. Listen, I was like, God, if I act like my season changed, okay, listen, here, I feel like I'm going to be flat broke, okay, God? Because I can sow them seeds, God. I can be obedient in that way, God, because I had it. And God was like, Father God. And can I tell you that some of you are only sowing enough to survive, but you're not sowing enough to thrive. See, you're doing enough to get by, but you're not doing enough to go into the overflow. Because can I tell you that what is required in the overflow is what is different than what's required in the survival? Because can I tell you, what you need to survive is way different than what you need to thrive. Because see, in order for me to survive, then I just need enough to pay my bills. I'm going to use that as a term. But in order for me to thrive, I need enough to go on vacation too. And see, God is saying that most of you, the reason why you're where you are right now is because you're only doing the bare minimum, but you want a more than enough God. Y'all, I'm going to be honest with y'all. All I want to do is just go in a corner and cry right now. Because I can talk about myself that so many times I wanted God to do more than what I was willing to do for him. I wanted him to increase, but I never wanted to decrease and take of myself so he could. I never want to let go of my pleasures and the things that I like in order for him to do something bigger in my life. And how many times is God wanting to do bigger things in our life, but he can't do bigger things in our life because we don't want to let go of what we have now? Y'all know that illustration where it's like the little girl is holding on to her little bear, and it's Jesus with this big old bear behind his back. And literally, because see, some of you have gotten so used to the little bear, and the little bear seems so big to you. And God is like, yeah, I know that little bear seems so big to you because that's all you've ever known. But if you want to see what I can do, and if you want to see greater, then you got to release this little bear in order for me to give you a bigger bear. Because see, some of you have grown so used to this little, and God is saying that, yeah, I know that your little seems much to you because that's all you've ever known. And see, it's easy for something to seem big when that's all you've ever known, but when God wants to take you to another level, he's like, listen, you gotta be willing to release all you've ever known if you want to be able to experience something that you never experienced before. And see, some of you are like that little girl where you don't want to give up your comfort. No. This bear has been with me through my poverty. This bear was with me when my mama died. And this was with me when I lost this. And I don't want to let go of it, God, because God, this has been with me all along. Come on. See, to the person, and I don't address these things always, but I want to address it today. See, to the person who's in a building, they only think that God can be in a building. They only think that people can be one when they're in a building. But to the person who's seen both sides of this, know that my God is still as good and faithful on this live today as he is in a building. Because let me tell y'all something about my ministry. In my ministry, I don't need you to come to a building for me to tell you about God, because all you got to do is get on the app that you scroll through every day, and I'm going to tell you about God. Because see, can I tell you something? That as long as the church is waiting on people to come to a building to experience God, you're going to lose a whole entire generation. So if you want to be able to reach the next generation, you might want to come up out your comfortable seat and go into their house, go into the place that they've been used to. Because it's easy to want the sinners to come to us, but in my Bible, didn't he say, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel? So listen, if TikTok is a part of the world, then I'm about to go into TikTok and preach the gospel. Because it's easy to preach the gospel in a building, but what happens when God tells you to go into another room? Come on. See, we want to tell people that they need to be in a building in order to experience God. But can I tell you, I've actually seen more miracles on a TikTok live than I've actually seen in a building. Why? Because We believe that God can be anywhere. We believe that God's presence is not subject to walls. And we gotta stop only subjecting God to walls. And we gotta start realizing that the church is not in a building, but the church is on the inside of you. And instead of trying to tell people to come to a building, how about you take that church that's on the inside of you to them? Come on. We are the church. We are the body. I can tell y'all something. I have people who are here. They have met their best friends through this ministry. I've literally been able to fly all over different places just because of this. I have literally been able to meet so many people and connect with so many people, and so many people have been able to get healed. So many people, I know so many people who are like, literally, they don't have no family, but because of what we do here, they have now found their families. They found their people, found relationships and so many different things. So what I will not do and what I will not ever let anybody do is limit God to one place. God is omnipresent. God is not limited. We can't limit God. We got to take the limits off of God. Come on, we got to take the limits off of God, because that's a religious mindset. Because religion tells you that you only can experience God inside of a building, but relationship tells you that you can experience God wherever you go. I experienced God at Drug Emporium today. I've been able to experience God in my back living room today. Do I go to a building? Do I go to churches? Well, yeah, I go to church and I go there and I serve there. But can I also tell you that I know that God is there, but I also know that God is here. And we got to get out of religion and get over into relationship. I'm not saying that the building is not effective, but what I am saying is don't discredit what somebody else is doing just because the way they do it is differently. The Bible says that it is the traditions of man that makes God to be of no effect. Don't limit God's effectiveness because of your traditions. And that's my rebuke for today. So back to the word, y'all. It says that in 2 Kings chapter 4, it says, "Now one of the wives of a man of the sons of the prophet cried out to Elisha for help, saying, 'Your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant reverently feared the Lord. But the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be his slaves in payment for a loan.'" See, notice that right before God provided for her, she was in a situation where it looked like she was going to lose everything. Looked like they were going to take her sons, and she was getting ready to lose everything as payment for this loan. Then all of a sudden, see, notice that the woman, it said, the wives of a man of the sons of the prophet cried out to Elijah. So notice that she went to the prophet. See, she could have went to worry. She could have went to fear. She could have stayed up all night. She could have given up. But instead, she went to a servant of God. She went to somebody who hears from God. And when she went to them, all of a sudden, God gave her direction that shifted her season. See, when God is getting ready to shift your season, God will send a word. When God is getting ready to shift your season, he will send a word. It said, "Elisha said to her, 'What shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have of value in the house?'" Can I tell you that just the fact that you have something of value in your house lets you know that God has the ability to perform the miracle in your life? Just the mere fact that you have value in your house is God's way of trying to tell you, listen, the provision you've been praying for is already in your house. The breakthrough that you need is going to come out of what's already in your house. See, so many times we're like, "God, I don't have you." You see, she didn't have the money. Oh, this is a word for somebody, Keisha. She didn't have the money to pay the debt, but she sure had the oil too. That's a word for somebody. She may not have had the money to pay the debt, but she had the oil to pay the debt. Come on. You see, it don't matter how much money you got in your account right now. Why? Because you got some in your house of value. And what God will do is God will start looking in your house and he'll start saying, what do you have of value? I'm not dealing with your bank account. I can shift that. I just need to know, do you got something that I can prosper? Do you got a seed that I can multiply? Do you got something that I can multiply? Because if you got something that I can multiply, you may not have everything that you may not have the money yet, baby. But if you got the business, if you got the product, if you got the inventory. Oh, can I speak to myself? Takaya, if you got the t-shirts, if you got the anointing oils, if you got the bracelets. Oh, my daughter. If you got the heat press and you got all the equipment. If you got the stuff, then I can multiply. Because what? Because my daughter, you got the value. See, she didn't need to have money because, see, here's the thing. She has something in her house that God can multiply. See, some of you right now, the reason why you're frustrated is because you're looking at the money, but you're not asking God what he wants to multiply in your house. See, you're looking at the money and you're mad and you're frustrated. But see, God is saying, I want you to start looking for the value. Look to see what in your house is of value. Stop looking for the money. The money is just a product of something of value. Because can I tell you that all money does is comes to measure value. I got to say this again. All money is to measure value. So see, notice that God didn't tell her to look for money. She said, look, he said, look for value. Why? Because if money is a measurement system for value, then if I want to generate money in your life, all I need is just value. Because money measures value. So if I want money to come, I just need value. I don't know if y'all getting this word today. Are y'all understanding what I'm saying? Are y'all getting this today? That it's not, you're looking at the money and the money is a measurement system for value. And God is saying today, stop looking at the measurement system and start looking for some value, so that way the money can come and measure it. Oh, I bet your money would come and measure some things in your house if you start realizing the value you got. I bet money would start measuring your time if you start valuing your time. I bet money would start measuring your coaching business if you start realizing the value of your coaching business. Oh, I bet money would start measuring your dispatching business if you start looking at the value in it. Oh, I bet money would start measuring them cups, Keisha, if you start realizing the value in it. Because God is saying, if you want to see the money to measure it, then you're going to have to realize the value. Ooh, I need somebody to realize the value today. Ooh, hallelujah. God, I need some people to realize the value today. I pray, God, they would realize the value of the book. Because see, the reason why you ain't wrote the book yet is because you don't see the value in it. See, the reason why you ain't done it yet is because you are preparing for God to not prosper it. Ooh! Talking to myself on that one right there. See, the reason why you ain't posted, the reason why you keep putting off making that link tree that God told you to make is because you don't see the value yet. See, you're not doing it because you don't see the money. And God is saying you ain't never going to see the money until you see the value in what I'm telling you to do. I want to run. I just want to run around my office so bad. God is saying you ain't gonna ever see the money until you see the value in what I've called you to do. I need some people to raise their value. I need some people to raise their value. I need some people to start seeing their value today. I need some people to start owning their worth today. I need some people to start seeing that they are King's kid, that they father on the cattle on a thousand hills, that they joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Listen, I need some people to start seeing that God is giving you too much value for you to be over there living paycheck to paycheck. Oh, I'm just going to go ahead and say it. God is giving you too much value for you to be living month to month. God is giving you too much value for you to not have more than enough, because God is putting so much value on you that literally, because I listen, if God has already created you to be in overflow, then you should be expecting overflow. And God is saying, until you realize that the overflow is already living on the inside of you, until you realize that the overflow is already giving you what you need to live in overflow, you ain't ever going to be able to live in the overflow. Because in order to live in the overflow, you got to understand that you already got the overflow. In order to live in the overflow, you got to understand that God has already given what you need to run over. God has already given you what you need in order to get out of your situation. Because imagine that the very thing that's going to get you out of your situation is already sitting inside of your house. Can I tell you that the oil was already in her house before she called on Prophet Elisha? And some of you feel like you ain't got that. The oil was already in her house before she went to the Prophet Elisha. I bet your breakthrough is already in your house before you pray to God. I bet your breakthrough was already in your house before you prayed to God. I bet your victory was already in your house before you prayed to God. Come on, I bet God is like, it's already there. But by your prayer, I'm going to show you where it is. Come on. Listen. I'm showing you what it is. I'm showing you right now what it is. Because listen, her coming to the prophet Elisha showed her where it was. See, I want you to start going to God with the expectation that he's going to show you where your breakthrough is. Hey, Blanca. I want you to start going to God with the expectation that he's going to show you where your miracle is. Come on. Listen, it says, she said, your maidservant has nothing in this house except a small jar of olive oil. What are you calling small that God is calling overflow? What are you calling small that God is calling overflow? Whew. Whew. What are you calling small? God is calling overflow. See, it says, then he said, go borrow containers from all your neighbors. Empty containers, and not just a few. See, before God could give her the overflow, he had to humble her. She had to be willing to ask for help, and she had to be willing to receive help. She had to be willing to ask, could she borrow some of their vessels? What if the reason why you ain't where you are is because you're not willing to ask God for help, or you're not willing to receive help? What if the reason why you're not where you are is because you're not willing to allow God to, because can I tell y'all a little testimony? So my daughter made some money in her business, and she wanted to buy Jordan, my spiritual daughter. She wanted to buy her some jeans or a shirt, something like that. I forget which one it is. And y'all know the Bible says, out of the mouth of babes, y'all. Out of the mouth. Y'all don't understand. These kids, they let me know I raised them up to know something, okay? And Addie wanted to buy Jordan some, and Jordan was like, no, because I don't want to take away from you. See, she didn't want to let Jordan bless her because she didn't want to take away from Jordan. She didn't want to take away. Jordan didn't want to let Addie bless her because she didn't want to take away from Addie. But see, what Jordan doesn't realize is that Addie has parents. Jordan knows it, but Jordan needs to have a bypass surgery, okay? Jordan doesn't realize that, see, Addie will never lack because Addie has parents who will never lack. So even if Addie buys Jordan something, Addie's parents are going to make sure that Addison is always supplied in full, so that way she can continue to be a blessing. Can I point out something for you? How many times are you rejecting the blessing that people are trying to give to you because you're afraid that if they bless you, they're going to lack? Realizing that their father is never going to allow them to run out. Not realizing that their father doesn't have to take from them to bless you. But because you're afraid of, and some of you don't know how to receive your blessing because you feel like in order for you to be blessed, you got to take from somebody else. But what she doesn't realize that in by receiving this blessing from Addie doesn't take from Addie. But what does it do? It causes God to even want to bless Addie more because God sees that Addie has a giving heart. Because when you have a giving heart, God can continue to bless you. But when you have a stingy heart, God can't bless you. And what she doesn't realize is that the reason why Addie is able to bless her the way that Addie's able to bless her is because the money that Addie is blessing her out of is out of Addie's overflow. Addie's not having to take from her needs to bless her. Addie's able to give out of her overflow because Addie's needs are already met because God has given her parents who takes care of her. And see, what you don't realize is that every time that you're rejecting that blessing is because you don't feel like God can take care of you and them. You don't feel like God can actually use them to bless you without having to take from them to do it. And if you would realize that the God that is backing them and is putting on their heart to bless you can take care of them, you would be more willing to receive. And you know what Addie told Jordan? She said, Jordan, you need to learn how to receive blessings. Whew. She said, you need to learn how to receive. You know what I told Jordan when they told me this story? I said, Jordan, if you can't even receive from an 8-year-old child, how are you going to receive from a big God? Whew. If you can't even receive from an 8-year-old child, how are you going to receive from a big God? Woo. How is God going to give you an overflow? And you can't even receive from people who don't even have nearly as much as he have. If you can't even receive from what man has, how are you going to receive from what God wants to give you when what God has is bigger than even what they're giving you? You heard Eli, he bringing me my tea. And God is like, how are you going to be able to receive the fullness of everything that I have for you if you can't even receive from people? You can't even let people help you. How you think you really going to go to that? Like Eli came to me today because the boutique is booming so much. He said, baby, we got to hire somebody. And I'll be honest, y'all, I'm sitting here thinking like, what is Jordan? I'm like, we need more people. And I said, well, listen, we finna put these kids on our payroll then, because they already make money from their business. But I said, if this game, they're going to be on our payroll, because listen, now there's a part of me that could be like, nah, I'm not going to let my kids help because I don't want them to do that. But my kids want to earn extra money. So I'm like, listen, you can come right over here and work for this family business then. See, in order for me to receive more, I got to let my husband help me. I have to let my spiritual daughter help me. I got to let my kids help me. I got to let people help me. And see, he told her that she needed to go get more containers from her neighbors. What if she would have never went and asked for help? What if she would have never went and trusted God? And it says, then you shall go in and shut the door behind you and your sons and pour out the oil you have into all these containers. Do you know how much faith it takes to pour out your little jar of oil that you got into, let's say, 10 of her neighbors? They don't say how many, but let's say 10 neighbors, right? Do you know how much faith it takes to pour your little jar of oil into 10 jars and believe that it's going to keep multiplying? Do you know how much faith it takes to trust that God is going to keep on multiplying this thing when everything is telling you that don't make no sense? And notice that in order for her to do this blessing, she had to shut out everybody. She had to go get what she needed. And he said, now, then you got to go in and shut the door behind you and your sons. Meaning, You cannot take advice from anybody other than this word I gave you, meaning that you can't let nobody else come into this room that you are about to do, that God is about to perform this miracle in. Because this miracle that God is about to do, there are only certain people that can be in the room in order for this miracle to be formed. Can I tell you that sometimes the reason why you ain't seen your miracle yet is because you got the wrong people in your room. Sometimes the reason why you ain't seen your breakthrough yet is because you got the wrong people in your room. And he said, and you shall set aside each one when it is full. So every time God fills it up, he says, set it aside. Every time God fills up another vessel, set it aside. Every time God does another one, I want you to set it aside. Why? Because these things that you are setting aside, and that can even be so correlated to today of how God teaches us that we are to set aside some extra for him to multiply. And it says, and when the containers were all full, she said to her sons, bring me another container. And he said, there is not one left. Notice what she said. After the containers were full, she said, bring me more containers. Can I ask a question? Because it doesn't tell us, so I want to implore. What if the reason why she asked for more vessels was because she had started to see the miracle so much that she had more faith to believe for more vessels than she had gotten in the first place? You ever only got ordered enough inventory to only just do your orders, but when you start seeing how quickly those are going, you start being like, you know what, let me go give me some more inventory, because let's do some more, because the way that God is blessing us, let's go ahead and do some more. Why? Because you started to see how much God can do. So because you started to see how much God can do, now all of a sudden you're like, okay, let's do some more. What if the reason why she asked for more vessels was because she started to see what God can do, and because she started to see what God can do, she now had faith to desire more. But can I tell you something? Even though she had faith from seeing the miracle to desire more vessels, because she didn't have the faith when they told her to get more than she got, she wasn't able to see even more vessels filled. Because see, if she would have just gotten more vessels in the first place, then when she asked her sons for extra vessels, then she would have been able to fill those extra vessels. But because she only got enough vessels based off of what she could believe for, by time she was ready, by time her faith had gotten to the place where she wanted more, she couldn't receive more because she didn't have any more vessels to put it into. Can I tell you something? Don't run out of vessels for God to fill. I want you to hear that. Don't run out of vessels for God to fill. See, if she would have been obedient, if she would have took her obedience further, she would have gotten more. But notice that God only gave her in proportion to her obedience and faith level. God will bless you in proportion to your obedience and faith level. Notice what it says. If you are willing and obedient, your portion is the best of the land. If you're obedient, you're going to eat, but you're not going to get the fullness of it. So if you want to see God bless you more, then you have to stretch your obedience and stretch your faith. Because if you will stretch your obedience and stretch your faith, then you will see God do more than what you have seen him already do. It says, and he said to her, there is not one left. Then the oil stopped multiplying. The oil could only multiply as much as she had vessels to fill. I want you to hear this. The oil could only multiply as much as she had vessels to fill. So what if the reason why you ain't seen the multiplication of it yet is because you have no more vessels for God to fill? Whew. I want you to think about a field. If I only sow five seeds that I'm gonna get a harvest, but imagine how much more I would have got if I would have sowed 30 seeds out there. Imagine if I would have sowed more, if I would have planted more trees, how much more of a harvest I would have seen. See, it says, then she came and told the man of God, and he told her, go sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your sons can live on the rest. See, God could have just left her sons with a poverty mindset. I'm going somewhere with this. But see, God didn't leave her sons with a poverty mindset. He let her sons see what it looked like to live in the overflow. He let her son see what it looks like to get to the point of where they were getting ready to lose everything before he gave them back everything. He let her son see what it looked like when you trust the prophet, when you trust God. See, some of you are in a place where I want to give some mama some hope today. This one goes out to my single mothers, okay, y'all? I'm giving my single parents some hope today. See, she had lost her husband, and her sons was getting ready to have to pay the debt because of something their father did. And it was getting ready to look like they were going to lose everything. But see, God showed what he can do for a single mother. That when it looked like she wasn't going to be able to provide for her sons, and when it looked like her sons was going to be sold and she didn't know how she was going to get out of that situation, all of a sudden, God literally came through. And some of you, you feel like your children have watched your struggle. Your children, they've watched you live paycheck to paycheck trying to make ends meet. Your children have watched you lose your house or lose your vehicle. And maybe you feel like you're in a similar situation where you have children and you're literally like, God, and this is for married couples too. And you're like, God, I never wanted my children to know the struggle that I knew. God, I never wanted my children to know what it was like to go without or to be in a place of lack. I never wanted my kids to know what it was like to go through poverty. But see, that may have been what they went through, but it wasn't where they stayed at. Can I tell you that they may be what you go through, but I decree and declare that ain't going to be where you stay at. Because see, her sons may have saw that, but her sons also got to see God overflow. See, sis, right now, your kids have watched you struggle. They've watched you go through it. They've watched you try to make ends meet. They've watched you lose everything. They've watched you literally have to live with other people. You've gone through homelessness. You lost your vehicle. You lost your business. You can't keep your job. And your kids have watched you do all these things. But can I decree and declare the same way that God did with the woman with the jar of oils, that where he not only allowed her kids to see the struggle, he allowed her kids to see the overflow. Oh, I decree and declare, your kids may have seen your struggle, but I want to prophesy over every mother, every father here today, that your children will see your overflow. They will see your breakthrough. They will see God do exceedingly and abundantly. They will see God give you more than enough. And even though you've had to walk through this season, and even though you didn't know how you was going to come out of it, oh, I just want to decree and declare on today that your children will see the promise fulfilled. I want somebody to type in the chat, my children will see the promise fulfilled. Come on, type that in the chat. My children will see the promise fulfilled. I want to go over to Ecclesiastes chapter 3, and I got two more places where we're going to go, and we're going to close this message out, and I'll probably prophesy over a few of you. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 says, there is a season, a time appointed for everything, and a time for every delight and event or purpose under heaven. Did you hear that again? There's a season, a time appointed for everything, and a time for every delight, event, and purpose under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot what is planted. a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search and a time to give up as lost. A time to keep and a time to throw away. Ooh, some of you feel like you in a throwaway season, huh? A time to tear apart and a time to sew together. A time to keep silent and a time to speak. That's a hard one. Come on. When there are times when God tell you, you can't tell your side of the story. Another time God say, okay, speak. A time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. It says, what profit is there for the worker from that in which he labors? I have seen the tasks which God has given to the sons of men with which to occupy themselves. He has made everything beautiful and appropriate in its time. He has also planted eternity, a sense of divine purpose in the heart of, in the human heart, and a mysterious longing with nothing, which nothing under the sun can satisfy except God. What God has done, it says, yet man cannot find and comprehend, grasp what God has done, his overall plan from the beginning to the end. You hear my husband, he is so supportive, y'all. Y'all can probably hear him in the background. He says, I know that there is nothing better for them than to rejoice and to do good as long as they live. And also that every man should eat and drink and see and enjoy the good of all his labor. It is a gift from God. I know that whatever God does, it endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor can anything be taken from it. For God does it so that men will fear and worship him with awe-filled reverence, knowing that he is God. That which is has already been, and that which will be has already been. For God seeks what has passed by so that history repeats itself. Moreover, I have seen under the sun that in the place of justice there is wickedness, and in the place of righteousness there is wickedness. I said to myself, God will judge both the righteous and the wicked, for there's a time appointed for every matter and for every deed. I want y'all to hear that there's a time appointed for every matter and every deed. Come on. There's a time for every matter and every deed. Praise God, Jeronisha, that you received your oil today. See, God is wanting for us to know today that every season is subject to change. And there's a time for every matter and every deed. And there's a time when God may have you doing one thing, and then there's another season where God may have you doing another. But if we don't prepare for the harvest that God is getting ready to bring us, we're going to miss out on the season that God is bringing. I want to go back to a story that I was talking about earlier. I was talking about how yes, my husband is here, which is the bro you need. I was talking about the story of how today, as I was driving home from my trip, I remembered that this land, and like I told you, I was listening to Prophet Wright, and Prophet White, I know you're here now, and that word was so powerful. And as I was driving home, all I saw was these cornfields. And God spoke to me, and he said, do you remember when this land was burned and barren, and it looked like nothing would come of it? Then he told me seasons change. I want to read y'all something because I Google, why do farmers burn their fields? It says farmers in many parts of the world set fires to cultivated fields to clear stubble, weeds, and waste before sowing a new crop. Wow. I want you to hear this. farmers in many parts of the world set fires to cultivated fields to clear stubble, weeds, waste before sowing a new crop. While this practice may be fast and economical, I'm gonna read that part. That's way more in depth on another level. I wanna get different things. Another one says, agricultural burning helps farmers remove crop residues left in the field after harvesting grain. Come on. They have to clear out the fields in order for the new grain to come. I'm going to look up what are some of the benefits. So benefits is control, it's able to control the sapling and the vegetation, and it improves the grassland for use by nesting wildlife and grazing livestock. So it improves the grass and it allows it to also control the vegetation. It improves the grass and it's able to control the harvest. I need y'all to catch this today. Oh, this is another one. Here's another reason why they burn fields. To reduce insect and disease pressure for the following summer. They burn the grass to reduce insects and diseases for the next summer. Woo! Come on. Oh, this is a good question. I want y'all to hear this. I wanted to know because I'm enthralled with this. It says, when should you burn fields? To achieve wildlife management and ground cover objectives on old field lands, lands that at some time had previously been tilled for agriculture, spring is the better time to burn the field. The end of February through mid-May is typically good spring burning weather. Isn't it crazy how there's a certain time, and it's February, March, April, May, that there's a 4-month period in which is the best time to burn the fields. Ooh, that's good. I want to read one more thing and then we're going to keep going. Ooh, this is good. Is this helping anybody tonight? It says burning. Come on. Burning is one way to dispose of the straw left after harvest so fields can be made ready for the seeding for the following spring. I want y'all to hear this. Burning is one way to dispose of the straw left after the harvest so fields can be made ready for the seeding for the following spring. Another reason is farmers burn their fields to remove plants that are already growing and to help the plants that are about to come up. What if the reason why you're going through a fire right now is because God is trying to help the plants that are trying to spring up? What if the reason why you're going through the burning right now is because God is trying to help and to prepare the ground and the grass for the harvest that he is about to bring into your life? What if the reason why you're going through the burning right now is because God is trying to clear out all of the things that could contaminate or affect or try to heat or would try to eat your harvest? Notice it has to get rid of the insects. insects. See, notice it has to get rid of the diseases. Why? Because that makes sure that the harvest is not ate, the harvest is not contaminated, and it also is making sure that the harvest is not wasted. Oh, listen, you didn't even realize the reason why you were going through a fire is because God is trying to make sure that your harvest is not wasted.
Come on.
You don't even realize the reason why you are going through what you're going through is because God is trying to make sure that your harvest is not wasted. Come on. I want to read one scripture, and all I want to read is one part. It says, "Test me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you so great a blessing." We just got another order on TikTok. Praise God. "Pour you out so great a blessing until there is no more room to receive it." See, in order for God to give you something to where you don't have enough room to receive it, is he needs substance. He needs your trust. He needs you to have faith, and he needs for you to release in order to increase. She had to pour the oil in order to multiply it. God can multiply what you're unwilling to pour out. God cannot multiply what you are unwilling to pour out. Come on. See, she had to be willing to pour out in order to multiply. And if you can't pour out, and if you can't surrender, and if you can't crucify your flesh, and if you can't be obedient to what God is telling you to do, and if you can't trust God, and if you can't stop acting like that he ain't gonna make a way where there seems to be no way, and if you can't get beyond this worry, how is God gonna pour out your blessing? How is God gonna increase what you won't decrease? See, you gotta decrease the worry in order for God to increase your faith. Come on. And y'all, this is my last scripture, and this is where we gonna close at, okay? Y'all, this word was rich tonight. This was a rich word tonight, y'all. This is where we're gonna end at. Y'all notice one of my favorite scriptures. It says, "Yes, indeed, it won't be long now, God's decree." I want to do something different today. I feel led to do something a little different today. I want y'all, I'm gonna start at verse 11. See, most times we start Amos 9, 13 through 15. We're gonna do Amos 11 through 15 today because I want y'all to see something. I felt led by God to do that, and now I understand why. Let's start at Amos 9, verse 11. Sorry, y'all. It said, "But also on that judgment day, I will restore David's house that has fallen to pieces." Notice what he said. I will restore David's house that has fallen to pieces. I'll repair the holes in the roof. Replace the broken windows. Fix it up like new. See, some of you right now feel like your house is falling to pieces, or you feel like you got some holes in your roof because it just seems like rain is getting into your house and trouble is coming into your house. And you feel like your windows have been broken. Maybe you feel like you that broken window. But notice what God says. In the midst of all of this, I'm going to fix it up like new. He said, "David's people will be strong again and seize what's left of enemy Edom." See, David's people had to go through being weak. Because why would God make you strong again if you never were weak in the first place? Come on. See, why would God need to restore their house if the house was never had to go through a period of being broken? He said, plus everyone under my sovereign judgment, God's decree, he will do this. Yes, indeed, it won't be long now, God's decree. So this is what he was telling to David's house. He said, things are going to happen so fast that your head will swim. One thing fast on the heels of the other. See, they had just came out of a season where their house was falling to pieces. They had just came out of a place where there was holes in their roof that needed repaired. I mean, they just had broken windows. They needed their house to be fixed up. And it was literally, they just came out of a season where they felt like they were weak and God had to make them strong again. And it was after them going through a season of being weak. It was after them going through a season of lack. It was after them going through a season where they felt like that their house was falling to pieces, that God then came in and gave them that Amos 9:13-15 blessing. See, so many times we just go right into the things are going to happen so fast, your head is going to swim. One thing's fast on the heels of the other. You won't be able to keep up. But what happened right before that? Because right before they got the Amos 9:13-15 kind of blessing, it talks about how they had to go through their house falling apart. They had to go through what it was like to be weak. And in order for God to give them the Amos 9:13-15 kind of blessing, they had to go through a season where it didn't look like Amos 9:13-15. They had to go through a season where it was just Amos 9:11-12. Come on. And when God was getting ready to do the new thing, they had to go through that heartache. They had to go through some things. But see, the Bible says, do not grow weary in well-doing. Why? Because in due season, you will reap if you don't faint. See, they had to be tested in their weariness before that they could receive that harvest. No. Some of you are going through the test of weariness. And you are wondering, God, when am I going to receive my harvest? But God said that if you're going to receive your harvest, you got to be able to endure the season of weariness. Can you endure your season of weariness on your way to your harvest? They had to go through what it was like to be weary before they could see the full manifestation of God. See, he said that what I'm going to do is, it's going to be like a night and day difference. It's going to be literally like a suddenly. It said things are going to happen so fast, your head will swim one thing fast on the heels of the other. You won't be able to keep up. Everything will be happening at once. And everywhere you look, blessings. Blessings like wine pouring off the mountains and the hills. I'll make everything right again for my people Israel. They had to go through what it was like for things to be wrong before he can make it right. He said they'll rebuild their ruined cities, but see, their cities had to be ruined in order for them to get to the rebuilding place. They'll plant vineyards and drink good wine. They'll work their gardens and eat fresh vegetables. See, they had to plant seed in order to eat the vegetables, right? I'll plant them and plant them on their own land. See, they had to know what it was like to be on foreign land before God could give them their own land. And it said they'll never again be uprooted from the land I've given them. See, they had to go through a season where they were uprooted from the land that God gave them in order to go back and be able to see how God was going to plant them again, and they're not going to be uprooted ever again. Why would God have to say they'll never again be uprooted if they didn't go through a season of being uprooted? See, what if the reason why you're going through what you're going through is just because God is trying to show you that this is an indication of where you're going? Oh, I decree and declare what you're facing right now. It's just an indication of where God is taking you to. Your name is Deasha. Well, do I want to do Rainer or do I want to do Deasha? Let's do Rainer. Rainer Lay or Rainer Lee. Worry is not going to fix your issue. Faith will. You've been praying to God for clarity because you feel like you don't know what to do. And you feel like you don't know where to go right now in this situation. God is funny. As I'm saying this to you, this thing just popped up on my computer. And it says, good boundaries and goodbyes. Good boundaries and goodbyes. Good boundaries and goodbyes. You told me that last week, and I put worry aside and persevered in faith, and God gave me favor. Come on. Ooh, good boundaries and goodbyes. That's where God is taking you to. Hallelujah. My sis D, you say call you D. I see faithfulness written all over you. I hear that in the spirit, faithfulness. And a lot of time your faithfulness gets you in trouble because sometimes you're faithful to the wrong things. You want to know what God had to teach me, D? Don't be loyal to the point that it kills you. See, I was so loyal to certain things and people to the point where it broke me. I was so loyal to certain things and people to the point where it cost me so much. And God says in this season, I am giving you wisdom and discernment. Jordan, all I hear is myself. And in this season, as I give you wisdom and discernment, you are going to know who is for you and who is just taking from you. Because there are leeches in your life. There are some people that leech off of you. Every time you get a blessing, you notice that they always come to get it. And all I see is, I see you carrying a bag with holes in it. Almost like it's difficult for you to keep money and difficult to keep your blessing. And it's like every time you get something, it just goes away. Like as if somebody just came and just dug in the bag or blew it away. Wisdom and discernment is going to be your guide. Wisdom and discernment is going to be your guide in this season. And God, somebody here, your birthday, it was funny because this is my daughter's birthday, but I just hear September 24th in my spirit. And you have been crying many, many tears. You have been crying so many tears. You've been really worried in a lot. Oh, D, that's your sister's birthday. Oh, wow. Well, come on, God. But I just see many, many just tears, just worrying. And you have literally just been asking God just like for finances. And literally it's to the point where if God doesn't provide, you're going to lose some stuff. September 24th, particularly. It's released now in the name of Jesus. Father God, right now, I thank you that the finances are released right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Who is Sarah? Somebody here named Sarah. You feel overlooked. And you feel like nobody cares about you. And you feel like everybody just takes advantage of you. And I literally just see that you just feel so overlooked and you struggle with rejection. And you just feel like the black sheep of your family, like an outcast, almost like, and I just see even them always trying to get you to just be quiet. It just seems like people are always trying to silence you or people are always overlooking you. And it's like, but I see like a visionary because God has called you to be a visionary because you have these visions for all these great things, but it's like difficult to do it because you lack the support. Where are you? If that is you, where are you? Because I just see you in the spirit realm. And I just see that you just lack support. God is sending you the support. God is sending you the people that you need. The people that you are been praying for, because I just see these big visions. And the vision that you have, it requires a team. But it's like you tell people your vision and they always shoot it down. Even to the point where people kind of make you feel like you're crazy for even dreaming it. God wants me to tell you this. You are not crazy, and stop saying that you're crazy. I must be crazy. No, you're not crazy. You got faith. Come on, you got faith. Amen. Linda, somebody named Linda, you just went through a bad breakup, like a relationship just ended. I just see a relationship that ended, and I see you wanting to go back, but I see toxicity. Don't go back. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Joel, I just hear God saying peace. I just hear the Lord say peace. Peace. You got a lot of decisions up ahead to make. I'm mad. I always come during your visions. Can you re-clarify that before my moderator see that and take it in a bad way? Peace. Thank you, Father God. Have your way, God. I know you was about to block them. And that's why I said, wait, I want to give them an opportunity because maybe they just wrote it the wrong way. Joel, I just see you have you have your guard up. Because even as I'm speaking to you, right? All I see is your guard up. So this is what I'm going to say, because this is what the Lord is showing me. The Lord is showing me that you're discerning. You're trying to see if I'm real or not. And your guard is up. You don't let many people in. You don't let many people get close to you. And there's a part of you that's like, maybe this is real, but then you've seen so many people that are false prophets. But there's also a part of you that feels like, maybe this is fake. Maybe this is false. And I can see it. So I can see that you're discerning me, and I can see that you're trying to see if I'm real or not. And you're trying to see of whether or not I am a false prophet or a real prophet. And you're trying to see, am I here to be a prophet or am I here to make a prophet? And so that's your answer. God is so good, y'all. And I just thank God for this word tonight. And I thank God for his faithfulness, man. Isn't God good, y'all? Isn't God so faithful in his word and just what he speaks? And I just thank God for everything that he does, y'all, and just everything that he is doing. And knowing that God is just going to continue that work and stuff. And you know, and some of you here, I mean, I always tell people, whenever you, like I can, you know what I mean? You see these things, you know, and stuff. And so just be faithful to God. Be faithful to God. Be faithful to God. But, you know, sometimes, you know, what I was going to say is just like, I know a lot of people here question, you know, and what I do, because I know what I'm doing is crazy and radical. Y'all don't think I ain't just as uncomfortable, right? And I know that, you know, in the platform and the place that God has called me to do and stuff like that is different, but I know God, you know? And one thing I always tell everybody, like, pray that God would show you me. That's my prayer. God, show them my heart tonight. And I don't pray that a lot because I know I can be a very closed off person. But a lot of times I know I struggle to let people see my heart because I've been burned so much in ministry and stuff. But my prayer is that God will show you whether or not I am real or not, because I don't measure my realness of who I am by people. I measure who I am by God, because in Takiyah, I need you to speak at my event so bad. Email me and inquire for it. But for me, you know, because I know that I can't do this without God. I know who I am. I know my failures. I know my flaws. I know my inadequacies. I know all that, y'all, and stuff. And so for me, when I do this by Him. I do this by His strength. To tell y'all I can get up here and preach. To tell y'all I can even do business without God. I humble myself to tell you, I cannot do anything without God. If you think any of this gets done without God, then you a fool. Literally, because this don't come by myself. It's all by Him. It's Christ in me, the hope of glory. It's not Takiyah. It's God. You know what I mean? And stuff. And so I just pray that tonight encourage you. And I pray that y'all come back and stuff. Y'all, it's offering time. You know, if you, like I always tell y'all in offering time, I know some of you, you already has started to sow and stuff. And so for those who feel led to sow, you can sow. Those who don't feel led to sow, don't sow. It's simple and stuff. For those who are like, well, why do you take up an offering? Well, because God told me to. And scripturally, the Bible says that those who teach are worth. We can go to Bible on that. But for me, I do it because this is what God has led me to do and stuff. And so I'm obedient to God. And really, you know what I found is anybody who knows God understands why. You know what I mean? Anybody who truly has an understanding of God, an understanding of who He is, and understanding the way He works. When somebody goes take up an offering, whether they're on a TikTok live, worthy of their hire, whether it's on a TikTok live, whether I'm in a building, you know, if I was a building doing this, they'd be like, oh, that's normal. But you know, on a TikTok, it's different and stuff. But I feel like anybody who truly understands God truly understands why we do it and stuff. And what I've learned is this, is that a lot of times the reason why people ask questions is not because they truly want to know. They ask questions because they don't want to sow, and it's easier for them to try to make you look like a fool than to just admit that they don't want to give and stuff. And that's just what it boils down to. And so I always tell people, listen, if you feel led to sow, sow. Do what God is telling you to do, because God is a faithful God, and His word never returns back void. I know, as somebody who tithes and gives offering off of personal life and business life, what God does in our giving and stuff. So for me, I get it, you know, but I also understand. And then too, for those of you who like don't have an understanding of giving or the different types of giving, if you go to my YouTube channel, The Sis You Need, you will actually see that I have a teaching on giving and stuff. And so I do that. I teach my people about it. I educate them on it, because I want you to give out of a revelation and not out of an obligation. Oh, that's a word, isn't it? Right? That was a word, wasn't it, girl? And so y'all, if you feel led to sow, if you would like to sow tonight, you can sow by Cash App, which is $ Takiyah A. You can also sow by Chime, which is $ Takiyah A. You can also sow by Venmo, which is at Takiyah Revelo. We have PayPal, which is Takiyah A Ministries. And then you can also sow by Zelle, which is Takiyah124@gmail.com. So and then if you would like to give by Apple Pay, then just click the link in the bio. Yes, click the link. Oh, we just got another order in our TikTok shop.
We got a lot of. Hey, would you hand me the MacBook? Because I want to look at the orders as we do offering time.
Awesome. We're running low on those.
We're running low on those?
Actually, all of our bags except the wild ones.
Okay. It's like, God. God, really? We're like, God, really? Lord. Yes, I do have Apple Pay. If you would like to give by Apple Pay, all you do is just click the link in my bio, and that will allow you to be able to give by Apple Pay, y'all. Yeah, Apple Pay is by clicking the link in the bio. Jordan, will you hand me the Deeper Realms anointing oil, please? It's a very good problem. It's a very, very good problem, Latoya, to have. Very good problem. Thank you. Because I'm going to need, I have to show this if I want to talk about it on my live. And we just want to say again, we just thank you to everybody who sows into the ministry, everybody who connects with the ministry via financially, and those who connect by physically as well, those who are here. We just want to say thank you just so much for just coming to the live tonight. Thank you so much just for supporting what God is doing in Takiah Revelo Ministries and what God is doing in the boutique as well. Y'all, we are truly just so honored and graced by God to be able to do this today, just to be able to come on these lives and do these lives. It is truly the grace of God by him just, and we just thank him just for the orders, and we thank you, God, for the people that sow into the ministry and stuff, because this allows us to get the word out of their out 7 days a week, y'all. And so we just want to say thank you to everybody who's here. And we just want to, we pray that you come back, but we pray God's blessing over you as well. If this is just your, if this is one of your last times too, as well. So I'm going to pray over everybody as you give. So Father God, I just want to thank you for everybody who gives tonight, Father God. God, your word says that you give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So Father, we just want to say thank you, God, as you continue to bless us exceedingly and abundantly. God, we just say thank you, God. We honor you, Father God. Lord, we thank you, God, for your goodness and mercy, which shall follow us all the days of our life, God. And Father, I just pray right now for continued blessing over them, for overflow and favor over their business, God. Lord, I thank you, God, that the clients are coming in, God, from all over, Father God. And Father, I thank you, God, that today, God, we are going to be obedient to do what you tell us to do, God. God, we're not going to hesitate. We're not going to procrastinate. No, God, we are going to be obedient to sow as you have led us to sow. We're going to be obedient, God, to do this word, Father God. And God, we just thank you, God. And Lord, I want to decree and declare Deuteronomy 8:18, because God, you have been showing me this all day long. So, Father God, I just decree and declare that we will remember the Lord thy God, who gives us the power to get wealth. We thank you, God, that you have given us the power to get wealth, God. And we just want to give you all the glory. We give you all the honor, Father God. And we just thank you, God, for your goodness and your mercy. And we just thank you, God, that you continue to show us your faithfulness, God. That even, but God, I thank you that even in our unfaithfulness, you remain faithful, God. And so, God, we just want to say thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, y'all, let's do this, because I'm excited because I can do this now. Okay. Okay, let's add this to the prop, to the showcase. Okay. Okay, let's pin that. Okay, y'all. So if you would like to shop with us with the Deeper Realms anointing oil, you can get this. There should be something that's pulling up where you can order from here. You can also go to our website as well, y'all, and stuff. So make sure y'all go shop with us. This is a 2 ounce bottle of our Deeper Realms anointing oil. We also have a travel size version of this as well, y'all. And so there's two different ways that you can shop this. You can go to the bio, or you can shop via here, y'all. And so make sure that y'all click, go to our store, go purchase your Deeper Realms anointing oil, y'all. And we have one person viewing our product right now. And so a lot of people ask us, okay, what is inside of this oil? In this oil, there's extra virgin olive oil. There is also, y'all, it comes with frankincense and myrrh as well. And this oil does come with a prayer card. Can you hand me the prayer card, Jordan, so I can show them the prayer card that comes with it for the Deeper Realms anointing oil? Thank you so much, honey. So this is the prayer card that will come with this. That way you will know exactly how to use it. So like I said, if you would like to get yours, just tap that shop button and it'll take you right there. And the card says, so a lot of people ask us, how do we use this? So with this anointing oil, all you do is you just take the oil. You can put it wherever you want to put it at. And you just pray this prayer. And the prayer says, Father God, right now I anoint my house so that every unclean and wicked spirit would have to leave now. God, I pray for your blessing over my family, my children, my marriage, and my finances. It says, open my eyes that I may see deeper into your realm. God, I command everything that is not working in my life to change now. In Jesus' name, amen. So with this, you're going to get the prayer card. You're going to get your 2-ounce bottle. So you can either get a 2-ounce bottle, y'all. Okay, yes. Go to pen. Okay. I'm making sure I got this done because it's telling me to do that. But yeah, with your 2-ounce bottle, you're going to get this how-to card, which is going to show you exactly how to use this. And so that way y'all know how to use your anointing oil. You know how to pray. And a lot of people say, okay, well, what are the things we can put this on? Some of you put it on them. You can put it on you. You put it on your children. Put it on your hair. Put it on whatever it is that you're wanting for God to change. Whatever you're wanting to anoint, all you do is just use your oil. And we use this is a 2-ounce bottle, and it is a dropper bottle. So as you can see, it is a dropper bottle and stuff. So if you would like, yeah, LaToya puts it on her husband. And that's so funny. And so, yeah, so if y'all are wanting to get your anointing oil, you can either get it via here and shop in my TikTok shop. All you do is just click that right now, or you can go to www.thisisyouneed.co. And so either way it go, just shop with us. And we have several other products as well, y'all. We have the oil of increase as well. We have t-shirts. We have Christian apparel. Now, if you want Christian apparel, you're going to need to go to the link in our bio and stuff. So y'all be sure to shop with us. So Kyra said she puts hers all over her house. Come on, girl. And if you have a testimony regarding your Deeper Realms anointing oil, make sure that you put your testimony in the comments. I ordered mine today. Can't wait to get it. Praise God. Yes, go place y'all's order. Make sure y'all place y'all's order today and get yours. They will be shipped out tomorrow. And so as you order, got to stay blessed. Listen, we blessed going in. We blessed coming out. We're blessed in the city. We're blessed in the land. We're blessed in the field. We're blessed everywhere we go. And so when you put this on, y'all, and I'm not saying that it's the oil doing it. What I'm saying is that God uses this. So God is doing it. God is doing it. And so I encourage you to go and get and tap in, y'all. And also as well, I want to tell y'all, oh, yay, we just got another order, y'all. We just got an order. Come on, praise God. Make sure you go and get your order. We just got an order from someone. I don't know who it is just yet, but we did just get an order. So to whoever just placed their order with us, thank you so much for placing your order. Thank you so much for going to get yours. Y'all, also, too, we do have tickets for our conference. So make sure you go get your ticket for the conference at www.thesisyouneed.co. Make sure you get your ticket to the conference for www.thesisyouneed.co. I love y'all so much. I pray blessings over y'all. Y'all have a great night and watch and see what God does in your life. See y'all tomorrow.